arrives in a wicker basket at 11 months old, all you want to do is be safe in your home. And at the same time, Dolly's growing up saying, who lived here? Well, why did they leave? And in the books, the school books in Israel at the time said, the Arabs preferred to leave. Technically, that's true. But prefer would be a little bit of a euphemism. And she, it didn't make sense to her. She's a very sensitive and very curious girl. And Bashir, of course, just wanted to go home. Now, the Arabs thought, well, we're going to be able to get our homes back and ride home in triumph on the backs of the army of Gamal Abdel Nasser, the president of Egypt, in 1967. I think probably almost everybody in the room here knows how that turned out. It didn't turn out as the Arabs had envisioned. Where the Palestinians, in particular, had dreamed fervently of returning to their homes, and also didn't turn out as the Israelis, almost to a single person, if you're of Jewish descent, that is, if you're Jewish, of course 20% of Israel is Arab, but for Jewish Israelis it was a re-invocation of the sense of incredible trauma, Holocaust kind of fear, you know, is this going to annihilate us? And of course, then when the word came that Israel had won this spectacular, in such a spectacular fashion, for so many people it was a war of survival. Now, imagine yourself being Dolly and at home, 19 years old, at Tel Aviv University, studying English literature, and the doorbell rings. It's actually the bell to the front gate that Ahmad Hayri had made and built with his crew in 1936. The bell rings. Who's outside? You can imagine who's outside. Bashir and his two cousins have decided that if they can't come home in triumph, that at least they could come to their old town and ask permission to go inside. So Dolly goes out to the front gate and she opens it, and there's these three Arab men in suits and ties. This is in the summer in Israel. And she told me later when I interviewed her, she said, I knew exactly who they were and why they had come. And it was like the answer. It was like a piece of puzzle that had always been missing for me. So Bashir says to her, this was my father's house, and I lived here too. And could we come in to see the house? Just imagine yourself in either position. What would it take to risk that sort of humiliation if you're Bashir, knowing, having heard the stories of people having the doors slammed in their face, people threatening to call the police, or the house isn't there anymore? Villages were, many, many hundreds of villages were destroyed by Israel after 1948. Here's this house is standing, here's this woman standing at the door. Now imagine being Dalia, three Arab men, literally the enemy is at your gate, you're home by yourself, your parents are at work, Moshe and Solia are at work. What do you do? Well, that's sort of the beginning of the story, in a sense, the beginning of the story of the lemon tree. And as you probably know or could imagine at this point, Dolly's answer is yes. Please come in. And so now I want to read to you a little bit here and there about this remarkable encounter between these remarkable people and these remarkable families. But first I want to just tell you a little bit about what it was like to be walking in up the path, the stone path your father had laid, your family had put down before you were even born, seeing the tree that you barely remembered, thinking about the lemon tree in the backyard, was it still there? And Dolly says, just hang on a minute, I'll be right back, I want to straighten up. And they're thinking, is she calling? What's going on? She literally wanted to get it prepared for her guests. Was coming, and she had to straighten up. She comes back, and I was remembering, all this, by the way, none of this is anything I've taken as poetic license. This is all based on documents and personal histories, memoirs, that diary entries that they've shared with me, or many, many hours of interviews I've done with them. And so, and we could talk a little bit about the house. I did some of the research, if you like, later. But so Dalia comes back out, and she brings them in, And Bashir, in one of the things he wrote about it, says, you know, I was touching everything. I was touching every wall, every surface, and I felt like I was in a mosque. And Dalia, when I interviewed him, she goes, God, it was like he was in a synagogue. And I suppose if there was a Christian there at the moment, it's like he's in church. You know? And that's how they remembered it, as something sacred. Something sacred, right? So now I want to read to you the moment, that afternoon of the beginning of this remarkable encounter, to give you a little sense of what was in the heart of Bashir at that time. As they were leaving, Bashir said, after some walking around, Bashir remembers that Dalia served what he calls Arabic coffee, what Dalia would call Turkish coffee. Those little very strong cups, delicious coffee, usually with a little sugar. And Dolly remembers serving lemonade, but anyway, they shared something together. And before they left, the cousins and Bashir left, Bashir said, and now I want to invite you to my house, he didn't say my home, my house, in Ramallah, where he was living in exile. And Dolly said, thank you very much. This was in the summertime. Now, that afternoon, Bashir arrives late, about 6 o'clock, but it's the end of the day. After the long journey, he gets home. Bashir climbs the concrete steps to the house in Ramallah. He opened the door and found his sisters and brothers, Ahmad and Zakiya, all waiting for the returning traveler. In the middle, in a chair at the kitchen table, sat Ahmad, father. Bashir couldn't bear it. I'm very tired, he said. The way was long, and the story is longer. Let me rest first, and tomorrow I will tell you everything. It was only 6 p.m. Sleep, my son, Ahmad said, his eyes watering. Sleep, Habibi, meaning dear, darling, my dear son. In the morning, the family was waiting. Bashir took his time, recounting every moment of the journey with his cousins. Everyone pumped Bashir with questions. Everyone, that is, except Ahmad, who remained quiet while the others demanded a replay of Bashir's every step, his every touch of stone. Did the light still stream in through the south windows in the afternoon? Were the pillars on the gate still standing straight? Was the front gate still painted olive green? Was the paint chipping? If it still is, Zakiya said, when you go back, you can bring a can of paint to make it new again, Bashir. You can bring shears and cut the grass growing up along the stone path. How is the lemon tree? Does it look nice? Did you bring the fruit you didn't? Did you rub the leaves and smell them? Did your fingers smell like fresh cut lemons? How were the stones of the house? Were they still cool and rough to the touch? What else, Bashir? What else? Please don't leave anything out. Throughout the interrogation, Ahmad had been still as a mountain, his eyes watering. Abruptly, he stood up, pushing back his chair. Tears streaked down his face as he left the kitchen and walked down the hallway. All eyes followed Ahmad, but no one dared call him back. He closed the bedroom door. God forgive you, my son, Zakiya said. You have opened our wounds again. And that's what happens so often with memory, is so associated with wound, but then not remembering, as I think, or not acknowledging someone else's memories, I think, has an even higher cost. Well, the conversation didn't really start that day. It started, but the argument didn't really start that day. And the argument, the respectful argument, the debate, the encounter continued when Dalia actually, on a January day in 1968, took Bashir up on his offer and completely by surprise showed up at his doorstep, that same set of concrete steps that Bashir had mounted some months earlier. Now, I'm going to read a little bit from that, and then I'm going to get into some moments of encounter, and then share with you some thoughts about what it might mean for restorative justice. Dalia had a friend named Richard with her that day that drove in this car across the muddy roads to West Bank on a January gray, wet day. They came to an overstuffed couch in a cold, darkened living room. Dalia was greeted with a quiet bustling. This is when after Bashir had come and welcomed her and said, please come upstairs. Someone rolled in a kerosene heater and someone else turned on the lamps. Bashir's sisters were darting about, preparing the sitting room for the surprise guests. This was the first time Dalia had seen West Bank women just as she imagined it was their first look at an Israeli.